I sincerely hope you can't see my dogs howling or something, but
Let's hope for the best. And we are now live on Facebook. Good evening, everybody, and welcome to today's session. Today is really a special session because we are talking about a very beautiful place, a paradise on this earth, Kashmir, the early history of Kashmir, the making of early Kashmir. And to talk about this, we have a very special guest, Dr. Sonalika Kaul from Delhi, speaking from Jawaharlal Nehru University. Dr. Kaul is a cultural and intellectual historian of early South Asia. She is an associate professor at Center for Historical Studies, JNU, New Delhi. She has also been the Malathi Singh Distinguished Lecturer in South Asian Studies at Yale University, that is in the US, the Jen Gonda Fellow in Indology at Leiden University, the Netherlands, the German Research Visiting Professor at the South Asia Institute, Heidelberg University, Germany. And she has written a lot of books, including The Making of Early Kashmir, Landscape and Identity in the Rajatarangani, that is also known as the first historical work in India, and that can be contested though. Then Oxford University Press, that was published by Oxford University Press in 2018, followed by Cultural History of Early South Asia, a Reader, Orient Black Swan in 2014, Imagining the Urban, Sanskrit and the City in Early India, published by Permanent Black and Siegel Books in 2010. And most recently, she had published Eloquent Spaces, Meaning and Community in Early Indian Architecture, Routledge in 2019. And Looking Within, Life Lessons from Lal Ved, whom we known as, I would request Mani to please mute himself. And the most recent book that she has written is Looking Within, Life Lessons from Lal Ved, whom we know as Laleshwari, and the Kashmiri Shaiva Mystic, published by Aleph in 2019. She has also contributed over 24 articles on Indian history and literature to international volumes and journals, including Cambridge World History, Encyclopedia of Historiography, Africa, America, Asia, History and Theory, Encyclopedia of Indian Religions and Indian Historical Review. She has also been invited to speak widely around the world, including at Sorbonne University in Paris, University of Sapienza, Rome, University of Witwatersrand, at Johannesburg, Australian National University at Canberra, Stanford University at San Francisco, Association of Asian Studies in Asia and the United Nations, among other international fora. So without further ado, I would request Dr. Kaul to begin with the lecture that will be followed by the question and answer sessions. So I would request every participant to write down their questions in the Zoom chat if they can. Otherwise, you all can send your questions to the Facebook live chat. Over to you, ma'am, and thank you so much for accepting our invitation.
Thank you. Thank you. Namaskar to everyone. It is a pleasure to be addressing all of you today. And I thank Ishan and Team Carvin for this very warm invitation. I particularly applaud this initiative because, as Ishan wrote to me, one of Carvin's aims is to revolutionize the way we understand Indian history. And what better way to do that than to include in this conversation called history a region, a part of India that has simply not received its due in academia, neither in research nor in course curricula, neither in textbooks nor in classrooms, in schools, colleges, or university. You don't see Kashmir, you don't hear of Kashmir. And this extraordinary region, Kashmir, was in fact a cultural colossus in early India, and yet we speak so little about her in the history that we do today. Let's see in this hour or so that we have on our hands right now, what we can do about this neglect, and what we can do to learn a little bit about the birth and emergence of this prodigious land as a historical culture region up to circa 12th century CE. Now, what is a region and how do regional identities form? We can begin to answer these questions by first recognizing that regions and their identities do not form overnight. They do not form in the short term, but instead cumulatively and in the long durée, in the long term. So the larger the time period we are looking at, the better we may understand a region and the trends and patterns that went into her making. As importantly, regions also do not emerge in isolation from each other. In fact, a region is by definition a unit, a subpart of a larger spatial whole, and typically it is defined in correlation to that larger supra-region or to other sub-regions of it. So regions in history do not usually form as secluded or insular entities. And yet, this is precisely what has been assumed about the Kashmir Valley, that historically and culturally, Kashmir was never a part of the Indic supra-region, but was isolated and hermetically sealed off somehow and evolved into a unique non-Indic cultural identity for this reason, because of her isolation. Sample this representative statement from the art historian Susan Huntington. Quote, "The Himalayan Valley of Kashmir has been geographically secluded from the rest of South Asia. Its geographic situation, bounded on all sides by high mountains, has led to an insularity that contributed to the development of its unique cultural characteristics," unquote. Please note three words of essence: secluded, insularity, and unique. So you see the pattern of thought, the thought process, leading ultimately to the characterization of Kashmir as an isolated, insular, and then a unique cultural formation. Now, identical vocabulary and statements are to be found in the scholar Mark Orlstein, who brought out the first critique of the Rajtarangini and its full English translation at the turn of the 20th century. He also uses the word secluded. A.L. Basham in the 1960s writing on the Rajtarangini, and Romila Thapar speaking about, again, Kalhan in the 1980s, they also talked about something like history writing in Kashmir emerging as an exception to Indic literary culture rather than an offshoot of it. So they thought that history writing in Kashmir emerges under the influence of non-Indic West Asian or Central Asian civilizations. Right down to the present, scholars like Walter Slaye, the philologist, or even Mike Witzel, for that matter, have also assumed in one way or another a certain geographical separation of Kashmir from the rest of India. Now, of course, Kashmir is surrounded by high mountain topography. We all know that, and we will be seeing some of that in the PowerPoint at the end of the talk. But let's not equally forget the presence of not one, but half a dozen major mountain passes around Kashmir that in fact connected her to the Indic plains. So I'm thinking of the Banihal Pass, the Sidau Pass, the Tosha Maidan, the Baramulla Pass, and so on. So all of these have to be factored in before we assume that a geographical difficulty of terrain translated into a historical insularity or isolation. Anyway, so this conviction about Kashmir's splendid, if imaginary, isolation has tied in also neatly with ideas of its peripherality to the Indic mainland. That is, any region that lay, that was an outlier to the Gangetic Valley was presumed to be a periphery to the Gangetic Valley as the center. Now, our lecture today will perhaps contest this unilineal understanding of regionality as something that perhaps flows from the center to the outlying region or periphery, and propose instead a model of multilinear cultural transmission. I will just explain that in a minute. But what this theory was about the peripherality of Kashmir to the Indic mainland actually took the form of suggesting that every aspect of its culture had non-Indic origins and influences. Let us interrogate these assumptions about Kashmir today, both about her isolation and about her being insular and developing this very different culture, unlike the rest of the mainland. Now, let me also clarify at this point that Kashmir is as unique as any and every region of this amazingly diverse country called India. Okay? So the point is not to question Kashmir's uniqueness or her specialty, but to question the assumption that this uniqueness derived from an isolation from the Indic mainstream. because that is simply unhistorical, as we will see today. So what I intend to do is to talk you through, of course, synoptically, an enormous expanse of evidence and its implications relating to the making of early Kashmir. I will draw on the iconic Sanskrit text, Kalhan's Rajtarangini from the 12th century CE, which is popularly believed to be the first history of Kashmir, but this is erroneous, that is not true. And I will draw on long durée testimonies from what I call cultural markers, art, material culture, script, linguistics, and more, to show how early Kashmir was historically never isolated or insular, but incredibly open, plural, and cosmopolitan, and also overwhelmingly Indic in her genesis and composition rather than peripheral. Tracing forgotten multilinear cultural flows and transmission of vast reach across space and time, friends, I give to you today the story of the astonishing connected histories of Kashmir over 2000 formative years of her history. Now, this term connected histories, I think you will all be familiar with because it is something that has come back into academic currency in recent years. Connected histories is the perspective that regions do not exist alone, but in a network of shaping interactions with other regions or with a supra-region. One look at all possible cultural markers of identity and mobility in Kashmir from at least the 5th century BCE onwards. So what markers am I speaking of? Material culture, textual representations, foreign accounts, inscriptions, coins, language, art, religion, philosophy, you name it. All of these attest overwhelmingly to Kashmir's spectacular, extensive connections and mutual involvement. The word from connected histories is mutual entanglements, not just with neighboring areas like Punjab and Himachal, but with centers of Indic civilization thousands of miles away in the deep interiors like Patna, Nalanda, Gaya, Banaras, Sarnath, Allahabad, Mathura, Malwa, Saurashtra or Gujarat, Gaud or Bengal, down till, hold your breath, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu in the far south. And I will give you examples of each of these. So here was cultural communication of astounding reach. Let us sample just a few of these resounding facts from different spheres of Kashmir's formative history up till, as I said, the 12th century CE. Civilization comes to Kashmir at the same time as in the rest of India, circa 6th century BCE, and in the same form, designated as the Northern Black Polished Ware culture that is associated with the rise and spread of cities, which was called second urbanization, as you will know, associated also with punch-marked coinage, commerce and state society. And where did the second urbanization occur? In the Ganga Valley and in central India and slowly all over the subcontinent. Now, the site of Semthan in district Anantnag, 44 kilometers out of Srinagar, south of Srinagar, has also yielded considerable evidence of the same NBPW material culture from 500 to 200 BCE. Including the same deluxe pottery, the silver and copper punchmark coins, and I'll be showing these to you, building construction, copper and iron objects, and semi-precious stone and terracotta beads. In other words, the entire material assemblage that is associated with NBPW and found across the Indic subcontinent is also emerging from the Kashmir Valley, not far from Srinagar. All these appearing in Semthan at the same time as the rest of India is very significant, but it should not be surprising because Kashmir was in fact connected to one of the two great pan-Indian trade and communication routes of early India, the northern Uttarapath, which in turn connected with the southern Dakshinapath. These two crisscrossing the subcontinent from its northwest to its southeast, that is from Afghanistan to Bihar and Bengal, and then from the southeast down south and southwest deep into peninsular and coastal India. Kashmir was geographically and historically very close to two of the northwesternmost cities of the Uttarapath. So it doesn't lie directly on the Uttarapath, but very close. Takshashila, the capital of Gandhar in the Peshawar plains, and connected to Kashmir. So Takshashila was connected to Kashmir via the Baramulla Pass. And the second city on the Uttarapath, the major city, was Shahkala, or modern Sialkot, capital of Madras in Punjab, and connected to Kashmir through the Sidau, the Tosha Maidan, and the Pir Panjal passes. So you can see there was great scope for actually all of these cultural traits and material traits to travel to and fro Kashmir and the rest of the continent through this major arterial route. The Great Indian Trade and Communication Network then connected through Shahkala and Takshashila to Srinagar, in the process, no doubt, transmitting, as I said, back and forth Indic culture, both material and intellectual. In fact, Takshashila and Shahkala, we know, were themselves great centers of Sanskritic learning in the period that we are speaking of, in the early period. But while at Takshashila, we get remains of Bactrian and Hellenistic material culture, in Kashmir, we do not. So that's an important distinction that often escapes many. Fact number three, Kashmir was a part of pan-Indian political formations from the very beginning too. That is, from the 3rd century BCE as a part of the Mauryan Empire that stretched across the subcontinent and whose Emperor Ashok founded the capital city of Srinagari. Did you know that? This is a very strong local memory that we hear of, not only in the Rajtarangani, but even in the accounts of the Chinese traveler Xuanzang, who came to India, including Kashmir, in the 7th century. He tells you exactly the story of Ashok being the founder of Srinagari. Please note that among the Panchma coins found in Samthan are the imperial type, what are called the imperial type, that numismatists believe to have been Mauryan issues. So even pre-Ashokan Mauryan issues. Also, the site of the Shankaracharya Math, the famous Shankaracharya Hill on the outskirts of Srinagar, is actually the ancient Jeshteshwara temple that the Rajtarangani tells us was again founded by Ashok Maurya. Later, Kashmir was also a part of the trans-regional Indic kingdoms of the Kushanas in the 2nd and 3rd century CE. And you know that their empire extended right up to Banaras in the east. And in the 6th century, the trans-regional kingdom of the Hunas. And their empire extended till Malwa in central India. And Kashmir was a part of these trans-regional Indic political formations. We also know that kings, queens, and ministers of Kashmir were drawn from different parts of India across the centuries. But first, would you believe it that Kashmir and Gandhar, that is Peshawar, were known to be the political allies of Magadh or Bihar? And the Nilmat Puran tells us that, that's a Kashmiri text from the 7th century, and the Harivansha Puran tells us that, which is the appendix to the Mahabharata. In fact, Mahabharata is one of the early Indic texts that enumerates Kashmir as one of the peoples inhabiting Bharatvarsha. And it names all these peoples and these Janapadas, and it enumerates Kashmir, as does the Brihat Sangahita later in great detail. So anyway, Kashmir and Bihar were political allies in the first millennium BCE. And I can't resist making this joke that if Pakistan wants Kashmir, it turns out they'll have to take Lalu Yadav as well. So that's how things were aligned in the first millennium BCE. But not just Gandhar and Magadh. Kashmir also had close marital and political histories with regions very far away and deep within the Indic mainland, like Pragjyotish or Assam, Gaud or Bengal, and the Cholas or Tamilakam. Take just the example of King Meghavahan of Kashmir, right? 5th century CE, the great grandson of an exiled king of Kashmir. He is given asylum by the king of Gandhar. So he is the great grandson of an exiled king of Kashmir. And who gives him asylum? It is the king of Gandhar, who then in time sends him literally across the length of the Himalayas to Pragjyotish, the capital of Kamarup, the capital of Assam. Why? For the swayamvar of its princess. Successfully winning the hand of the Assamese princess, Meghavahan then returns to Gandhar loaded with wealth and also with the Vishnu Chhatra, or the royal parasol of the Assamese king. So Kashmir and Assam. Meghavahan then is invited by the ministers of Kashmir to come back and ascend the throne of Kashmir, which he does. So you can see these amazing cross connections in Kashmir's political history. In the same way, zooming to the 12th century, King Bhikshachar, a prince of Kashmir who is cast away at birth, he grows up where? He grows up in the Malwa court in the Deccan as the adopted son of the Malwa king. And eventually he returns to Kashmir from the Deccan and wins back the throne and rules in Kashmir. Still other rulers from Malwa, like Pratapaditya and Matrigupt in the 6th and 7th centuries, and they are believed to have been descendants of the legendary king Vikramaditya, they were also invited by Kashmiris to be their king, showing again how Kashmiris actually subscribe to the North Indian politico-mythic universe. So clearly, Kashmir's internal politics did not occur in isolation at all, but it was a porous process that was intricately tied up with other kingdoms near and far. And we will see through the lecture how this porosity and this interconnectedness actually deepens. It goes well beyond the political to extend to virtually all aspects of culture. And remember, it is a mutual process. It is not a one-directional or a unidirectional movement. And I'll show you why I say that. Now, not just that, the Raj Tarangani tells us that Kashmiri kings like Jalauka, Mihirakula, so Mihirakula is a Huna but ruling in Kashmir, and he's enumerated as a Kashmiri king by Kalhan, Meghavahan, Pravarasen, and Shankaravarman. That means from approximately the 2nd century to the 7th century, these Kashmiri kings are said to have launched military expeditions deep into the Indian subcontinent. So this is what I meant. It's not a one-way movement of kings from other parts of India to Kashmir, but Kashmiri kings also ventured into the subcontinent as a part of their normal political and military business. Now, these may be rhetorical claims of conquest or they may not, but most notably, the 8th century stellar Kashmiri king, Lalit Aditya Muktabir, he is said to have undertaken raids and conquests in northern India, including against Kanyakuj. Kanyakuj is Kannauj, the symbol of imperial sovereignty in early medieval India. I'm sure you will remember this from that whole chapter on the tripartite struggle that you were taught for the early medieval period. There is no mention of Kashmir. So nobody tells you that Kashmir was a player in this fight for that symbol of sovereignty that was Kannauj. Now, not just Kannauj, Lalit Aditya goes further east. He goes up till Kalinga and Bengal, we are told. In fact, the Raj Tarangani luxuriates in detailing what Lalit Aditya brought back from Bihar, from Magad. Namely, colossal Bodhisattva statues gleaming in bronze. And these are called Brihad Buddhas. And if you're wondering what they look like, just think of the Bamiyan Buddhas in Afghanistan. They were made of stone. And here we are talking of bronze Brihad Buddhas. And they are brought back by Lalit Aditya from Bihar to Kashmir. And there's an elaborate description of how they are loaded onto the backs of elephants. And the iron, Kalhan says that the mark of the iron straps that were used to strap on these Buddhas to the backs of the elephants can still be seen on the statues in the 12th century. So here is an invocation of the present to justify the past and to prove the past that Lalit Aditya actually undertook this conquest and brought back these Brihad Buddhas. What is also fascinating about this memory of a momentous transfer of artwork is that it tallies with the influence of the Pala School of Art of Bihar on the famed Kashmiri Buddhist bronze industry. So there's a historical basis to this literary anecdote. And what is this Kashmiri Buddhist bronze industry that I'm referring to? Best examples of these were commissioned by and survive to this day in the monasteries of Tibet. And I will have occasion to show you illustrations of these. Moreover, Lalit Aditya's Shri Pratap type of coins, so a series by him called the Shri Pratap coins, have also been found in massive hoards from half a dozen places in UP and Bihar, including Nalanda and Mungir, and in UP in Aunjar, Bhitwari, and Sarnath, reaffirming perhaps the political and commercial presence of Kashmiris deep in the Ganga Valley. So perhaps nothing so far-fetched about the story of Lalit Aditya coming in. And yet, you and I have not heard of him in the mainstream histories that we study. Now, interestingly, kings of Kashmir and even ministers, when they retired from work or when they left on exile, typically turned Indiaward, Gangetic Valleyward, traveling to and settling in the iconic cities of the Indian plains. For example, King Jayapid in the 7th century went to Prayag on being ousted from the throne. And Kings Kalasha in the 10th century and Matrigupta in the 6th century before him, following their abdication, went to Kashi, they go to Banaras. And so did the ministers of King Harsha in the 11th century. And there are many other examples. That's not all. In the Rajtarangani, people of all strata, so not just kings, but of all strata from modern Punjab, I'm using these words for convenience, Haryana, UP, Bengal, Malwa, Karnataka, and Tamil Nadu are seen migrating and settling in Kashmir over the centuries. So several queens of Kashmir, for one, were drawn by marriage from remote regions. Rana Rambha, the adopted daughter of a Chola king, Rathi Sen from Tamil Nadu, was married to King Ranaditya Othunjina of Kashmir. Amrit Prabha, we already saw, she's a princess of Assam, and she was married to Meghavahan. Prince Toraman in Kashmir was married to an Ikshavaku princess from Andhra. Princesses of Jalandhar are mentioned as the wives of King Anantadev, while King Susala is married to the granddaughter of the ruler of Kalanjar. And Queen Didda, who ascended the throne of Kashmir in the 10th century herself, was born of a Shahi mother from Gandhar. So what I'm trying to tell you is a very cosmopolitan nature of the Kashmiri royalty. And this is complemented by an equally eclectic composition of other ruling elites. So not just the kings and queens of Kashmir were coming from different regions, but their ministers and their courtiers and their generals were also drawn from other parts of the country. So the universal king Lalit Aditya, he's described as Sarvabhaum, universal, and one whose intellect, Kalhan says, exceeded that of the more parochial rulers of his time, Pradeshik Eshwara. So there is a clear idea of sovereignty in Kashmir in the 8th century under Lalit Aditya, which places Kashmir as the center of the world, as it were. And there is this aspiration for a universality rather than the narrow cultural limits of a vernacular identity, a regional identity. Now, this King Lalit Aditya's advisor was a man called Sankun. And who was he? He was a Tukhara. Tukhara is Bactria. We also know King Jayapid's chamberlain was Pramoda. Who is he? The ruler of Mathura. King Anantadev's jester is a man called Dallaka, and he's said to be from the Ganga Plains. And the same king's ministers and confidants, Keshava, was from Trigartha, that is Kangra, and Padmaraj from Malwa. So you can see a truly cosmopolitan court. And in the service of King Harsha in the 11th century was a man, Keshin, from Karnataka, if you please. And in fact, the dynamic, if Quixotic King Harsha of Kashmir went so far as to introduce Kannada couture, Kannada fashion and apparel in the royal court. So from Kannada to Kashmir, and this is the 11th century we are talking about. Talk about cosmopolitanism. And he also introduced a new coin type which depicted the elephant. Now, you know, the elephant is as far removed from Kashmiri ecology as possible. So obviously this was also a Kannada inspiration. So a very interesting episode from Kashmiri history that in one go reflects on her incredibly open society and polity. At the same, Harsha's court was also a minister from Takkar, which is Punjab, and so on. I could give you many more examples. They're all there in the book. I think some of you may like to browse through it. It's a slim book, but it's a crash course in the early history of Kashmir. Why I'm even giving you all these details is so that you understand that we are looking at a pretty solid phenomenon in history. And this is not our understanding is not based on stray references here and there. There is a pattern to Kashmir's openness and her cosmopolitanism. And this goes into the making of early Kashmir. That's what we need to understand. Now, while regional courts attracting courtiers from far and wide may not be exceptional, right? Because in medieval times, other courts were also doing that. But in Kashmir, we seem to be looking also as a society-wide phenomenon. So we talked of kings and queens, we talked of courtiers, and now we discover in the Rajtarangini that it is not only courtiers, but commoners, and not only Brahmins, but a potentially mixed bag of individuals migrating to Kashmir from outside in pursuit of their vocations. And not all of them are coming under state patronage. There are a large number of non-state actors also involved in this. So what do we have? For example, we have Bengali students from Gaud who are coming to Kashmir as early as the 8th century CE to study in Kashmir. We have magicians, references to magicians from Dravid Desh in Kashmir. We have graziers from Khasha. Khasha is either Uttarakhand or it is Nepal. We have prostitutes, quote unquote, from different countries. We have traders and baniyas, that word is being used, baniyas, from Rohitaka. Rohitaka is modern Rohtaka in Haryana. And you have baniyas coming from Takkar, which is Punjab. We also find references to artisans and horse dealers coming from the Ganga plains. Kings Lalitaditya and Jayapid in particular are said to have gathered from many lands various learned men. So kings are doing their own bit in fueling this process of demographic movement. And of course, there are the very common references in the text to Brahmins and Bhikkhus from Madhya Desha and from Arya Desha, and also from Gandhar and from Dravida and from Saurashtra and Lata, that is Gujarat, being settled in large numbers in the valley or flocking to it on their own. Ladies and gentlemen, the demographic implications of all this migration into Kashmir are then fundamental for assessing the question of Kashmiri identity in the early period. I'm sure you will see that. And it is certainly not an identity that is insular, that is closed and inward looking, far from it. Now, quickly, for other cultural markers, language. The earliest historical languages we have in Kashmir are Prakrit and Sanskrit, just like the rest of the subcontinent. These were quintessentially languages of wider communication. This is seen in a large number of the coins and inscriptions recovered. In fact, not just from Kashmir, but also from Gilgit-Baltistan, which you know lies to the north of the Kashmir Valley, from Jammu, Ladakh, Gandhar, and Chamba, as well as seen in the epithets of local kings like Maharaj and Shri, and to their Sanskritic names. For example, the Patol Shahi rulers of Baltistan, Nava Surendra Aditya Varman, Manidhara, and so on. We also see Sanskrit in documents such as the famous Gilgit manuscript and the Bakshali manuscript, which was in the news recently about that whole debate about the origins of zero. It's a mathematical manuscript. So we find all of these in Sanskrit at this time from this region. Indeed, it is through Kashmir and Gilgit-Baltistan that, along with Buddhism, Sanskrit, which was described by Xuanzang as the language of India, the language of Indu, as he called it, spread in the Trans-Himalayas. So Kashmir played a pivotal role, please note, in the spread of Buddhism from outside of India. And this is, again, hardly acknowledged. We hear of the role of kings like Ashoka, yes, but we don't hear of the role played by the community of Kashmiris, in as early as the first millennium CE. People like Kumaraji, for example, who was a Kashmiri, who was born of a Kashmiri father, married to a Kucha princess. And he actually plays a huge role in the transmission of Buddhist learning all across Central Asia and then China. He's also called to China for this purpose. Okay, so I'm saying, I will talk about Buddhism a little later, but I'm saying that not just Buddhism, but Sanskrit is also transmitted by Kashmir to the Trans-Himalayas. That is in Khotan, Kucha, Turfan, these are places in Sinkiang, and ancient Sogdia, that is modern Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan, and Tajikistan. So we have to understand that actually what we understand as the Indic cultural regime extended far beyond what is normally assumed. And there is massive manuscript and epigraphic evidence from these lands that I have just named from the 5th to the 10th century, attesting how these were actually well within an Indic cultural regime. But what about Kashmiri, the vernacular term? What do we know about Kashmiri? Though there is no early material evidence of it being written so far, references in the Rajtarangani suggest that it was spoken in domestic or non-formal context from early on. The origins of Kashmiri is a significant question, since language is, as you know, it's deemed an important indicator of ethnic and cultural identity. So where did Kashmiri come from? What do we know about it? George Grierson, I'm sure you've heard of him. He undertook the linguistic survey of India, the first linguistic survey of India in the 1880s. Now his view from 100 years ago that Kashmiri was a Dardic and not an Indo-Aryan language has long been rejected. After the work of linguists like George Morgenstern and more recently, Colin Masika and more recently George Morgenstern, it is now accepted that the so-called Dardic languages like Kashmiri and Sheena could not actually be distinguished from Indo-Aryan languages at all, but were simply, quote, a bundle of aberrant Indo-Aryan hill languages, unquote. What's more, linguists tell us that these so-called Dardic languages, such as Kashmiri, can in fact be traced to a form of speech that closely resembles archaic Sanskrit. Archaic Sanskrit, how do we know about that? Because it figures in the Vedas. I think you know that Vedic Sanskrit is different from classical Sanskrit. And Kashmiri, linguists say, has a number of similarities with this archaic Sanskrit, and it is mediated through Prakrit. So there are various peculiarities of the Kashmiri tongue, phonetic peculiarities such as conjunct consonants and missing sibilings and so on, which are believed to be features of this archaic language. Now, zoom out. If this is correct, then Kashmiri and Sanskrit and the majority of Indic languages derived from Sanskrit would be what are called cognate languages, that is related languages. So that linguistically as well, we are looking at a horizontal continuum between Kashmir and the rest of the Indian subcontinent. So we are seeing continuities again, not just in material culture, politics, but also in something like language, which is an important indicator. Now, after language, what about writing? The earliest writing we get in Kashmir is on Indo-Greek and Kushana coins. And this is the Kharoshthi script. The Kharoshthi script, which you know is actually found fairly extensively in North and Northwest India and continues to be found till about the 2nd century CE. So you're finding it in Kashmir as well. But around that time, Kharoshthi suddenly dies out and it is entirely surpassed by Brahmi. Brahmi, the quintessential Indic script from which the vast majority of Indic scripts today are derived. Now, the best examples of Brahmi showing up in Kashmir from the early period are the legends on the coins of the Kidara and Huna dynasties, which I will be showing you. Not just Kashmir, but north of Kashmir too. We have found some 5,000 inscriptions and petroglyphs. Petroglyphs are essentially graffiti graffiti that have been made on stones and boulders along the Indus River in Hunza, Gilgit, Chilas, and what is called the Karakoram Highway. So these are all parts of what we know to be Pakistan-occupied Kashmir today, that I'm referring to. They are north of Kashmir. And you have found 5,000 ancient petroglyphs. 80% of these petroglyphs that have been found are in Brahmi, dating from the 3rd to the 7th century CE, suggesting that this Indic script was firmly in use across this region. And mind you, these petroglyphs or graffiti and writings are being inscribed not only by locals of this area, but scholars have worked out that they were also being inscribed by travelers and passersby and traders. So very interesting that they could also use Brahmi. So we have to actually open up our understanding of this region as going well beyond the boundaries that we thought of heretofore. The epigraphist Oscar von Hinüber also tells us that this Brahmi that is found in North Kashmir, north of Kashmir, shows affinities with, where do you think? Mathura Brahmi. Mathura Brahmi is the Western style of Brahmi that is identified with Mathura from the 2nd to the 6th century CE. Now hold on to that thought, because there's more. Now, within a few centuries after Brahmi being found all over this area, by the 8th and 9th centuries, Brahmi evolves everywhere in the north, northwest into a new script, a new regional script. And this is the Sharada script. I sincerely hope you have all actually heard of this script, because she is close to extinct today, which is a huge travesty of the great intellectual position that the script held for centuries in Indian history. And today there are a handful of people who actually know it. We are going to be studying the Sharada script, by the way, in this course on epigraphy that I'm teaching in JNU right now. So that should be interesting. Now, this Sharada script, as it evolves, what do you think it was influenced by? What do you think this transformation, evolution of Brahmi into Sharada is influenced by? It is influenced by Eastern Gupta Brahmi of Allahabad. So the earlier Brahmi you're seeing in North, Northwest India is under Mathura school of Brahmi. And now you're getting the Allahabad school of Brahmi with its straighter, narrower, and less ornate lines. Sharada continued to be the script par excellence of Kashmir right till the 18th century. And some people will also tell you that even today there are manuscripts that survive. But beyond Kashmir too, and I will show you the spread of Sharada in my PowerPoint, beyond Kashmir also, we see that at the level of writing or communication systems, there is again a geocultural continuity over the entire area from NWFP in Pakistan to Ladakh, Peshawar, Kangra, Chamba, and Punjab, right up till Delhi and Mathura region, with Kashmir, of course, as the pivot. What do I mean? That Sharada script is found all across this vast area. So this area, this regional formation or culture region that I'm outlining, that was centered on Kashmir, but spread out far beyond her, can actually be profitably called the Sharada region also. Because here you have this distinctly regional script called Sharada, and that reminds us of Kharoshthi, because Kharoshthi was similarly playing a regional role in the entire area, not just Kashmir. Finally, our last cultural marker, and perhaps the most visible marker of connectivity and of mobility, and that is art. Kashmiri stone art or sculpture has been traced by art historians in every one of its stages from the 4th century to the 10th century at Bijbihara, then at Baramulla, and then at Pandrethan. These are three important sites in the Kashmir Valley. In every stage, Kashmiri school of art has been traced to the influence of the Gupta, post-Gupta, and Pala art styles, and from three specific centers of Indic art that were thousands of miles away. What are these three centers? Sarnath, Udaygiri, and finally, Nalanda. So this is phenomenal, and it has actually been demonstrated iconographic relief and motif for relief and motif between these schools, and the uniqueness of those motifs occurring only in these two locations. I will show you some of this. What did this repertoire of Kashmiri art consist of? That is also fascinating. It included iconic pan-Indic Buddhist and Hindu images, such as, of course, of the Buddha, the Bodhisattva, Trimurti, Vaikuntha Vishnu, Maheshwara as Bhuteshwara, many-armed Durga Mahishasur Mardini, and I'll be showing you photos, Harihara, Ganesha, Kartikeya, Matrikas, Brahma, Surya, I could go on. And these are all found complete with their, again, very, very Indic motifs, such as the Yajnopavit, the Vanamala, the Kirita Mukuta, an assortment of Vahanas, and so on. In fact, even the beautiful iconography on Kashmiri gold coins, which are called dinars, right from the Kushanas through the Kidara kings like Negavahan, and for the next 1200 years, numismatists tell us that Kashmiri gold coins directly adopt the design that is found also in the Gupta Empire, depicting, for example, Shiva with his trident or the Trishula on the obverse, and a seated Sri Lakshmi with a lotus in hand on the reverse. I will be showing you all this, and they're beautiful, completely perfected and refined iconographic formulae. And this continues to be the Kashmiri coin formula for 1200 years. That is truly phenomenal, that cultural continuity that we see. So as art historian John Seudmuk tells us, at every stage of its development, early Kashmiri sculpture displayed a constant synchronicity with Northern Indian artistic developments. Constant synchronicity, meaning it was constantly in tandem with the kind of things that were going on in important centers of Indic art elsewhere. Of course, Kashmiri art is also inclusive of local innovations. No doubt about that. So for example, one feature that is unique to Kashmiri stone art is the monumentality of the art. So you have 1 to 1.5 meter high images on an average. The second typically Kashmiri feature is the use of a green chlorite stone rather than the Gandharan schist or the Mathuran sandstone, right? So we are getting a different stone that is used. There are several other finer nuanced differences in art that are dancing chamundas, dancing matrikas is again something you find in Kashmiri art. Vaikuntha Vishnus, Maheshwara as Bhuteshwara, these are Kashmiri takeoffs on pan-Indic icons. Indeed, for 2000 years, Kashmiris seem to have worshipped the same gods as the rest of the subcontinent as well. Shaivism, Shaktism, and Buddhism in Kashmir are as old as Kashmir itself, in a manner of speaking. And it is Kashmiris, as I said earlier, who took Buddhism from India to China and to Central Asia. In fact, even in the 11th century, when Tibetan Buddhism is undergoing this revolution under Rinchen Zangpo, where does he look for his education and training in Buddhism? 11th century CE, mind you, he looks to Kashmir. He studies his Buddhism in Kashmir. And when he's building his iconic monasteries and viharas in Lahore and Spiti, and of course in Tibet and in Ladakh, where does he get his artisans and architects from? He gets them from Kashmir. So reiterating the two millennia long centrality of Kashmir to the Buddhist ecumen as well. This is important to note. It's not typically known about Kashmir. In fact, ironically, when studies today or departments in the world that are studying Western Tibetan Buddhism, ironically, they talk only of Ladakh and Lahore and Spiti in India, and of course of Tibet, and they miss out on Kashmir. And you can see why that is ironic, because Kashmir in a way was the fountainhead of different schools of Buddhism right from the beginning, Sarvastivad to Madhyamikas, and then of course the Tibetan Buddhist revolution. So that is Buddhism, and Kashmir takes it out. The Sharada temple, you would have heard of this. It's a famous matha. It's a famous peat, the Sharada peat, today lying derelict across the line of control in a village called the Neelam village in Pak-occupied Kashmir. The Sharada peat was once visited by pilgrims from as far as Bengal in the 8th century CE, and we have references to this, and is also listed in the 11th century by Al-Biruni as one of the top three shrines of Al-Hind. So of the entire Indic subcontinent, Al-Hind, Sharada in the north of the Kashmir Valley, alongside Somnath in Gujarat and Thaneshwar, are deemed by Al-Biruni to be the top three shrines of Al-Hind. Great Indian philosophers like Nagarjuna, Vasugupta, and Shankaracharya taught in Kashmir, while Kashmiris themselves, hear this, frequented Gaya and Kashi so much that a 9th century Kashmiri minister sought tax exemption for Kashmiris at these centers of faith. So this is an extremely interesting piece of information, because it is simultaneously showing you a discrete sense of Kashmiri identity that give exemption to the Kashmiri community coming here, but also how frequently Kashmiris subscribe to this pan-Indic ritual economy. So it is actually showing you, and this is, it is important to get this clear, that the universal and the local are not necessarily binaries. They're not necessarily exclusive choices that a people or a community have to make. So we were told till now that Kashmir is parochial, she is regional, she is insular, she had nothing to do with the Indic universal. And here we find a lovely little symbolic historical piece of fact to demonstrate how Kashmir, and the Rajtarangini herself is an excellent example of how Kashmiris actually wore their local and their universal, their Kashmiri and their Indic badges with ease. There was no sense of, there's no dissonance between these different labels in someone like Kalhan, when he's composing such an out and out regional poem called the Rajtarangini, dedicated only to the history of Kashmir, but is doing that in the quintessential language of wider communication, the quintessential cosmopolitan language, as Sheldon Pollock has called it, Sanskrit. And thereby that is pointing to the sphere of circulation, and also to the conceptual universe, the semantic universe that Kashmiris are inhabiting in the 12th century CE. Okay, and no surprises again that Kashmir is clearly not isolated from the supra region. And in fact, the example of Adi Shankaracharya is again a very good graphic representation of what we are talking of. Very quickly, I suppose you know that Adi Shankaracharya is supposed to have undertaken in the 8th century, three digvijayas, intellectual tours of conquest across the entire Indian subcontinent. And it's given great detail, the regions that he goes to, debating with the local scholarship and establishing the supremacy of Advait Vedanta. He makes it a point to culminate every one of these three digvijayas where? At Sharada Peet in Kashmir. And why? Because the Sharada Peet is known as the Sarvagya Peet. That is the seat of omniscience, the seat of all learning. And Shankara has to go there to stake his claim definitively after having conquered the whole land of India. He has to get that affirmation from Sharada Peet, from Kashmir, that yes, he's entitled to ascending the Sharada Peet thanks to his tremendous scholarship. So here is an indicator of the centrality of Kashmir in the far north to the imagination of a Shankara from the far south. Because Shankara sets out from Kaladi, I think you know, in Kerala. And he is traversing the entire Indic subcontinent and ends up every time at Kashmir. And this is truly fascinating. And finally, not to forget, the long line of virtuoso Kashmiri poets and philosophers themselves. So I told you it's not unilinear. It's not just that people or thought or ideas or philosophies or art from other parts of India are going to Kashmir. It is also Kashmir then becoming the fountainhead, the fount of a lot that became defining of Indic culture. What do I mean? So this long line of Kashmiri poets and philosophers, Vaman, Udbhat, Mammat, Kshemendra, Anand Vardhana, and Abhinav Gupta. Now, you may not have heard of all these names, which is again a very sad commentary on what we do in our classrooms with you. But believe me, these were big shots of their time, and consider that across the subcontinent, intellectual big shots. Who were they? What did they do? They revolutionized Sanskrit aesthetics and literature and monopolized the intellectual scene across the country throughout the first millennium CE. We are talking about 1,000 years, and well into the second millennium as well. You have to only pick up a book like Rasa Reader by Sheldon Pollock and look at the number of Sanskrit poeticians and theoreticians and linguists that he is talking about, and see how many of them are Kashmiri. And what are they doing? Their work circulated not just in Kashmir. Their work circulated widely and was studied as learned models even in the deep south of India, in Tamil Nadu, in Andhra, and in Karnataka. Something that scholar Whitney Cox has recently very colorfully described as saffron in the rasam. So a little bit of Kashmir in Tamil, Andhra, and Kannada literary cultures. And literary culture here doesn't just stand for a poem here or a play there. It actually stood for the most happening, the most cutting edge sphere of intellectual history of pre-modern India. Okay, allow me to show you some visuals now and to conclude thereafter. Help me here, Ishan.
So now you can share the screen. You can click on the green button and
zoom in. Can you see something? Not yet.
Not yet.
Okay. Now you can see something?
Yes, yes.
Perfect. And we can start. All right. This is the region we are speaking of, Jammu and Kashmir. You would all be familiar. This is a zoomed in version. Do you see Srinagar? And do you see the pale brown area around her, oval shaped, running from northwest to southeast? That is the Kashmir Valley. She lies couched between the Pir Panjal range to her southwest and the Zanskar range to her northeast. Now you can see it is clearly a very high mountain topography, but you can also see a number of the passes around her. So you can see Banihal, you can see Baramulla, you should be able to see the one going into Ladakh as well. But anyhow, this is not a map of the passes. It is there in the book. Connected histories is what we have been seeing today, extensive connected histories. And these are the very large number of places, right from Hunza and Gilgit in the north till Tamil Nadu in the south, Assam in the east, and Saurashtra in the west, and of course, Gandhar, that Kashmir was intensively connected with. I think you will agree, we have seen, even in this little vignette that we could manage today in 45 minutes, we have seen a large number of examples. All right, this is not coming in the right order. I will come back to this later. Please remind me. I talked about the Sri Pratap coins of Lalit Aditya being found in thousands of coin hoards across Uttar Pradesh and in Nalanda. Here is one photograph from the Banda district. I'm sorry about the order. This should have come later. Chronologically, this is again something I talk about in the book, but I talked only of history today. I did not go into prehistory, but archaeologists have discovered, the ASI has demonstrated, how as early as the 4th millennium BCE, that is when the Neolithic period was on in Kashmir, already by then you are seeing now not any unique Neolithic. Do recall your BA syllabi when you were studying the Neolithic cultures of India. You were told about how the Kashmiri Neolithic at Burzahome and Gufkral is unique and that it is unlike any other Neolithic culture in the subcontinent. And now what have archaeologists shown? They have actually shown tremendous commonalities in material culture between the Neolithic at Burzahome, Gufkral, and Kanishkapura, that you can see on the map here, and what? And the bronze cultures of the Harappan bronze cultures of Punjab and Haryana. So three sites in particular, Kunal, Bhiranna, and Rohira in Punjab and Haryana, have thrown up identical material cultural patterns. And here I'm talking pottery, I'm talking motifs on pottery, I'm talking of a very particular kind of crop, which is a combination of emmer wheat and barley, which is found only, till now it was found only in Neolithic Kashmir, and now it has shown up in Harappan, Punjab, in Haryana as well. I am also talking about Chalcolithic tools and so on that have shown up in Neolithic Kashmir. So we are looking at this motif, for example, the horned deity motif that we associate so well with the Harappan culture has also shown up in Kashmiri Neolithic at Kanishkapura. So we are looking as early as the 3rd or 4th millennium BCE at a somewhat common cultural pattern, material cultural pattern that is emerging across the valleys of the Vitasta, that is Jhelum, Chenab, that is Punjab, and the Ghaggar Yamuna area. So in that area, we are looking already at these commonalities between Harappan and Neolithic. Of course, coming into the historical period, this cross linkages are completely intensified and they appear in very sharp relief. This is the extent of the NBPW culture I was talking about, covers practically the entire Indian subcontinent. And now we know that Kashmir was also a part of this map. Silver punch mark coins, diagnostic of NBPW culture or the second urbanization, have been discovered at Simthan, including the imperial type that I was referring to, which are Mauryan coins. These, you can guess, are the Uttarapatha and the Dakshinapatha, the arterial cross-subcontinental communication and trade network, which probably was responsible for the kind of connected histories that we are seeing between Kashmir, because through Takshashila, just a little right of Takshashila, and through the Baramulla Gorge, you enter the Kashmir Valley. Coins. Kushana coins, Kharoshthi legend. We spoke about these. These are Vima Katfis's coins, Kanishka's father. And what do you see on these coins? You are seeing a king with a trident, a Trishula, and an altar. And on the reverse, you are seeing Shiva himself and Nandi standing behind him. And the Kharoshthi legend reads in Sanskrit, Maharaj Vima Katfis's. So even when we speak of these Central Asian ruling groups that came into India, whether they are the Shakas, the Kushanas, or the Pahlavas, it is always important to inflect our understanding of these groups by the phenomenon of their own Indicization. Their cultural choices that they made reflected in their names, reflected in the faiths that they adopted and patronized, and reflected in the language and art that they cultivated. Kanishka's gold dinar. Again, you see Shiva standing, and it is written also, it is identifying him as Oesho, that is Shiva. Kidar coins, Meghavahan, the king I was telling you about, of Kashmir. You are seeing Brahmi legends now, and clearly in relief, you are seeing Shiva with the trident. And it looks like a horse, but numismatists tell me with conviction that that is actually the tiger that is sprawled at his feet, or the lion that is sprawled at his feet. And the Trishul, of course, is unmistakable. And on the reverse, you see the seated Sri Lakshmi with the lotus in her hand. This becomes the lasting iconographic numismatic representation of Kashmir for 1200 years. And it bears the typical terminology of Maharaj and Jai. Jai to Maharaj Meghavahan. Same for the gold coins of Pravarasen in Kashmir, 6th century, the same formula. And the gold coins of Tunjina, and so on. At this point, I could have gone back to the Lalit Aditya coin hoards found all over UP and Bihar. But coming to the Sharda script, this is what it looks like. This is the distribution of Sharda inscriptions so far, or Sharda writing, not only inscriptions, also manuscripts. Kashmir has thrown up 35 of these samples, Gandhar 12, but see the rest. Swat is northern Pakistan. Jammu, and by the way, Swat is also Swat and Kashmir's master regions of North Pakistan and NWFP. Recent research is showing how even the artistic trends in Kashmir and North Pakistan were shared. There was a continuity between them, and all of it was deeply Indic. Jammu is throwing up Sharda, so is Ladakh. Chamba has 36. So she emerges as the largest, and Kangra has 3, and Delhi also has 1 from the early medieval period. So you can see it is quintessentially a Kashmiri script, but it extends far wider than just the provenance of Kashmir. Interestingly, just as Sharda evolves from Brahmi, from Sharda evolved a script known as Devashesh, and it is from Devashesh that other regional scripts emerged, such as Dakari in Himachal and Gurmukhi in Punjab. So you see the lasting legacy of Sharda in the northwestern region, and again, not just Kashmir. And this history, it is around us, it is surrounding us, the presence of Sharda and still earlier Brahmi, and yet we may not be able to recognize it because we don't get to study these enough. Finally, talking about art, some of the icons we have got from the first stage of Kashmiri stone art, Kumar Kartikeya, look at the Yajnopavit, the Janeu. The short Janeu is typical of Kashmiri iconography. Look at the Vanamala that is going right down till his knees. That is again classic Kashmiri. The Kirita Mukuta, the Vahana, see the swan. Eka Mukhalinga, found at Koti Tirth in Baramulla. See the representation. And then the Eka Mukhalinga from Udayagiri. Art historians have identified a great similarity in nuances between these two representations and not elsewhere. Colossal lingas in situ in Baramulla. And these are huge. I wish I had a photograph that actually showed a man standing next to them, because these are colossal. And they are strewn all across, or they were strewn all across the Kashmir Valley. And how do we know this? Because number one, Kalhan in 12th century is telling you that. And 8 centuries after him, Oral Stein, who is traveling through Kashmir on horseback, he is telling you that. These photographs are taken by Oral Stein in the 19th century. So till at least then, these survived. Today, one is unsure of what the situation is there. This is Maheshwara as Bhuteshwara. So this is Shiva with Uma to his right, and that is Nandi to his left. Uma to his left and Nandi to his right. And the interesting thing about Bhuteshwara is that it is a Kashmiri innovation of Shiva. And secondly, do you see the hair parting of Shiva? The parting in the center and the hair combed to both sides. This is known in art history as the window effect. And where has this window effect been found? Either in Kashmir, in Bhuteshwara, or at Nalanda, only. So art historians have again concluded that this phenomenon, this particular art motif, again reflects on the connected art histories of Nalanda in Bihar, the Pala histories of Pala art history of Nalanda and Kashmir, because this effect is exclusive to the art history of Kashmir or Nalanda, and no third region. Finally, Vaikuntha Vishnu, again, a Kashmiri innovation of Vishnu, showing two of his avatars simultaneously with him on either side of him. In fact, 3, there is one at the back of his head also, which you can't see. Here are 2 examples. These images today are in the Met Museum in New York. They are not here. Indrani, a matrika, and see her pose. Scholars say she's supposed to be dancing. And again, she's 1.5 meters high. And this dancing matrikas is again exclusive to Kashmiri art. The Tibetan Buddha in the Bhumi Sparsha Mudra, Kashmiri art, Kashmiri bronze, Sire Purdu is the method that was used in Kashmiri bronze industry, and it is the same as that which is used in bronze manufacturing across India and certainly under the parlors. And who is it being made for? It is being made for the Tibetan Buddhist monasteries, and that is where this beautiful image is recovered. Shiva and Parvati with Kartikeya and Ganesh. So a stock pan-Indic iconographic formula, and you're seeing many images of it in Kashmir. The splendid Durga Mahishasur Mardini, the multi-armed, 18-armed Durga Mahishasur Mardini in green chlorite, the distinctive stone of Kashmir. Thereby hangs a tale. This sculpture was smuggled out of Kashmir in recent times and ended up in Germany. And only about 4 years ago, on the initiative of the government, she was returned by the German government to India and now is safely back in the Shri Pratap Singh Museum in Srinagar. A splendid, enormous image of the goddess in her Raudra form, the Durga Mahishasur Mardini. And finally, connected history that we have been talking about once again to wrap up the kind of evidence that we have been looking at. Okay, so very quickly to conclude, you can see that these images are only a glimpse of the intensely connected histories of Kashmir and the Indian subcontinent for over 2,000 years, and a glimpse of the fundamentally plural, open, and vibrant nature of Kashmiri society and culture in early times. It is indeed time that we sat up and took note of Kashmir's many achievements on every level of civilization and society. Thank you very much for this opportunity to speak to all of you. I'll be happy to take a few questions.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for this legendary landmark lecture that you have presented today to introduce Kashmir to a wider audience in such lucid and interesting manner. And I'm reminded of just one couplet from the medieval time, that is, agar firdaus barue zameen ast, hami ast to hami ast to hami ast.
Interesting, interesting intervention here. So we identify the characterization of Kashmir as a paradise with the medieval, right?
Yeah.
But in fact, the reference to Kashmir as paradise occurs in Kalhans Raj Tarangini first.
Wow.
So again, the continuities, right?
Yes.
Please,
yes,
please
definitely.
Go ahead.
So we have got many questions. So we'll take around 4 or 5 questions. The first question is from Sunetra Mitra, and her question is, did Lala Aditya patronize Buddhism? She visited Naranag recently, and the temple there was built by Lala Aditya. So do you think he patronized Buddhism?
Lalit Aditya, not Lala Aditya. Lalit Aditya Mitra. Yes, he patronized multiple faiths. So his personal spiritual advisor, Sankun, I mentioned the Tukhara, he was into Buddhism and he founds a number of stupas. So does Lalit Aditya. But then he also patronizes Shaiva temples and the lingas that I referred to that are set up all across Kashmir. So he's not the only one. We find multiple kings from Kashmir who, regardless of their personal faith, are actually into multiple simultaneous patronage of different sects. So you have Surya worship being patronized also by Lalit Aditya. The Marthanda temple, you know, which has become famous now in the movie Haider, that's founded by Lalit Aditya, and it is devoted to the sun god, right? And as you said, the Buddhist stupas and the Shaiva temples also. And we have other kings who are doing exactly the same thing. So I'm glad you brought that up, because this is part of the extremely important story of Kashmiri pluralism that has been all but forgotten today. And history is attesting that in every stage of Kashmiri origins and its formation. Simultaneous multiple patronage, king after king, queen after queen, courtiers, And common people are also going and worshipping these different people. So the kind of straitjacketing that we in the 21st century tend to think is correct between Buddhist and Shaiva or Vaishnava faiths actually may not have been that watertight a compartmentalization for practice in ancient times. And here I'm speaking not just of Kashmir, but of other parts of India. There is plenty of epigraphic and literary evidence to suggest that people, commoners, were also into cross-patronage. So they would worship Buddha, but also perform Vedic sacrifices, also worship Saraswati, and go to Jaina sacred sites. And sites like Aihole, for example, also show that you have multiple, you have Buddhist, Jaina, and Shaiva temples all happening in the same space. So Kashmir, yes, for the 2000 years we are tracing, was a beautiful example of Buddhism and Hinduism coexisting simultaneously. This is not to say there were not tensions. In the Raj Tarangani, you do find references also to tensions, but nonetheless, both prospered clearly.
So the next question is from Anoop Tantri, and his question is, ma'am, what do you have to say about the influence of Indus Valley culture and the few sites found in Kashmir? Is there a specific reason as to why we start Kashmir history with the period of second urbanization?
Because history by definition is only from when written records are available. So that is why the 6th century BCE, not just for Kashmir, but all of India, is regarded as the beginnings of history, the historic period. Before that, the Vedic is described as proto-historic, because we are getting literature, but we are not getting writing or as much writing as we would expect. And the period before that, the Harappan period, again would come under proto-history, because we have writing, but it's not been deciphered. So that's the problem there. Your question, so that's why we also talk of we talk today about the history beginning in the 6th century BCE. But then in my PowerPoint, I of course showed you, I made a brief reference to precisely the Harappan period and the material cultural continuities that you're seeing with Neolithic Kashmir. So I would not like to use the word influence, but I would like to speak of obvious exchange and interaction and interface between Kashmir and the Punjab and Haryana plains, Harappan plains, from as early as then. So I think that conclusively demolishes this whole construction of Kashmir as this secluded region who was lost unto herself and had nothing to do with the world outside. Clearly, even Neolithic Kashmiris had better sense than that.
So the next question from Sagnik Sarkar, and his question is on the, can you comment on the utility of Shimendra's work like Samaya Matrika in the status of women in the Kashmiri society?
Oh my. No, I can't do that offhand. But remember one thing, for Sanskrit works in general or for any literary, pre-modern literary works, they don't always profess to be talking about the regions the poets belong to. So these are general satires that these people compose, and they are typically not even located in necessarily historical locations, but they might actually be constructing a certain literary imaginary, which you can analyze then and discuss whether it's gender or whether it's even notions of polity and so on. But did they apply to Kashmiri society simply because the poet is Kshemendra? You have to be a little careful in making that association, unless the poet himself says that this was true of Kashmir. But for more specifics than that, I don't have anything on hand right now.
Another question from Sagnis is, do we find any other references to a Stri Rajya in Kashmir, as mentioned by Kalhana in association with the Lalita Aditya's campaigns?
So if you're speaking of Kalhan, he doesn't speak of a Stri Rajya in Kashmir. I know historians and scholars have made that extrapolative jump and said that Stri Rajya was in Kashmir because it finds mention in the Raj Tarangani. But if I remember my Raj Tarangani right, Kalhan carefully refers to a Stri Rajya, but it is north of Kashmir. Not immediately north, but it is north of Kashmir. So we do not have an exact identification for it yet, but he doesn't speak of it as being in Kashmir. Sorry for that. But yes, Kashmir, to strike a feminist note, so as not to disappoint you altogether, Kashmir does throw up female rulers, and from fairly early. So the historical example we have is Queen Didda in the 10th century. and she rules with a very iron hand. So she's actually called Didda the tyrant, and people are actually really scared of her. So that's interesting. I don't know if that's good, but that's interesting. But mythically, you actually hear of female rulers in Kashmir from at least 1500 years before that, where the Nilmat Puran tells us that in a battle, so remember I told you that Kashmir and Bihar, Kashmir and Magad were allies, political allies. And Magad was under the king Jarasandh. And Jarasandh, if you remember from your Mahabharat, was the arch enemy of Krishna. And Jarasandh is responsible for routing the Yadavs from Mathura and making them flee to Dwarka. And the Harivansha Puran tells us that Kashmir is supposed to have played a role in this political siege of Mathura. So later, at another point in a battle, Krishna kills the second named king of Kashmir called Damodar I. And he puts in place of him his own baby son, his infant son, as the next king, but makes his mother Yashovati the queen regent. So Yashovati is perhaps the first queen of Kashmir to actually rule in Kashmir, and she is occurring very, very early in Kashmir's political history. So here is a sign, perhaps. I don't want to make too much of it, but here is a sign, perhaps, of women and how they were doing in Kashmir or where they are placed. We also know, remember, that Kashmir is a deeply Shakt society, Shaktism. And Shakti worship, as I have argued in a recent piece in a media house, Shakti worship is actually defining of Kashmiri identity, and explicitly so, because even the origins of Kashmir, I don't know how much time we have, Ishan, but even the origins of Kashmir are supposed to occur from a lake that was Sati Saras, that was the lake of Sati, the consort of Shiva. So the Nilmat Puran first in the 7th century CE and then Kalhan in the 12th century CE explicitly says Kashmirah Parvati. Kashmir is Parvati. And alternately also that her rivers Vitasta is also Uma. And remember Vitasta, that is Jhelum, is flowing right through Kashmir. So from the southeast to the northwest. From the northwest to the southeast, but running right through. So she is the artery, she is the lifeline of Kashmir, and she is identified clearly with Uma or Parvati. That is just one example. Even Lal Died, the Kashmiri Shaiv poetess I mentioned, the yogini from Kashmir in the 13th century, she also talks about how the very land of Kashmir is Vitasta, the waters, and it is nothing but running from the Har Mukha, from the mouth of Shiva, to Vishnupada, the feet of Vishnu. And Parvati appears as the Nau Bandhana, Parvati appears as the boat that leads to the salvation in that lake of the people there during deluge and so on. There are other examples of why I'm saying that Shakti worship is actually central to the self-image of Kashmiris for millennia. And in this also reflects really on the larger question of women in Kashmir, in Kashmiri history and Kashmiri thought.
So we'll take two last questions that are there on the Zoom chat, ma'am.
Sure.
First is from Mihir, and his question is, what could be the possible reasons behind the creation of isolated Kashmiri identity, and what is the reason behind a renewed interest and need for revisiting that identity? And many term that identity as Kashmiri. So do you agree with that terminology?
As?
They term Kashmiriyat.
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 Okay. For starters, let's get one thing clear. Kashmiriyat is not a historical term. It's a term of political coinage. And very recently so, only around the partition, only around 1947. Kashmiriyat is invented, as it were, as a term by Nehru and also by Sheikh Abdullah to signify, as it were, that as India was undergoing the bloodiest partition along communal lines, Kashmiriyat was made to stand, to bear the burden, as it were, of a secular India. So Kashmir and her Kashmiriyat was deemed, you know, which talks of coexistence of different faiths, was deemed to stand in and bear this burden, as I said, of a secular India, while that secular India was actually falling apart all around us in 1947, 1948. So it is not a historical term. In fact, it is historically a thin term because it implies coexistence of multiple faiths. Whereas from the 14th century till about the 17th century, in very quick time, an entirely Hindu and Buddhist population was converted to an Islamic population. Practically all of it was, right? Even today, the proportion of non-Muslims in Kashmir, the valley itself, is very, very small. So we are not talking coexistence, really. We are talking of one demography transforming into another through multiple historic processes between the 14th and the 16th centuries. But yes, in some pockets of Kashmiri history, such as Kashmir Shaivism and Kashmiri Sufism, which interestingly is also known as Rishiism. So this will give you a little window into what we are speaking of, because some of the early Kashmiri Sufis, the indigenous Sufis, not the Sufis who are coming from West Asia to Kashmir, they are actually very orthodox people. But some of the indigenous Kashmiris who convert to Islam and who emerge as Sufi saints, and I'm thinking of Nund Rishi, someone who's known as Nund Rishi. He was Sheikh Nuruddin. He was a Muslim convert, a Kashmiri Muslim convert, but he is known as Nund Rishi. So a Hindu term will indicate the kind of fondness in which he's held. Now, the Sufism that he preaches and this Rishi order that he founds, actually, and this will come as a surprise to most people, actually has great continuities with Kashmir Shaivism. So there is Kashmir Shaivism and Kashmiri Sufism, at least Kashmiri Rishiism, at least as represented by Sheikh Nuruddin, represents a lot in common. And what is that which is in common? It is the understanding of what's called unity of consciousness. So in Sufism, there is a concept of Tawhid-e-Wajudi, which is the unity of being. And in Kashmir Shaivism, there is the concept of Paramashiva, who stands for nothing but that unified, pure consciousness. So there was perhaps a ground for Kashmir Shaivism and Sufism to have a dialogue in Kashmir. But that is not tantamount to Kashmiriyat, the way it has been projected. And of course, recent developments in the last three or four decades in Kashmir, where we have seen a very theocratic terrorism really, you know, bursting in our faces in Kashmir, also puts paid to this whole idea of Kashmiriyat as, you know, a land where there was complete communal harmony, because clearly there was not. And that is what gave rise to the kind of murders we have seen since the 1990s. Your original question is a good one about why was Kashmir understood to be secluded and isolated and insular? And honestly, my guess is as good as yours. I do share in your surprise, because by the time I got through my research for writing this book, even I was left wondering that how could 200 years of scholarship have missed this abundant evidence. And you know, it is not just one text here or one a piece of art there. It is all variety of historical sources seem to be speaking in unison. And let me let you into a secret. Halfway through my research, I had actually expected to find in early Kashmiri history a hybrid culture, because we have been told that Kashmir is a borderland, that Kashmir is actually an Asian crossroads, and that she is the seat of West Asian, Central Asian influences and so on. Everything but Indic, actually. So I was fully expecting to find evidence of that kind of cultural hybridity. And yet when I started reading the sources one by one by one, all of them were speaking in unison towards a deeply Indic cultural composition of Kashmir, and not for one or two centuries, but as I said, for two millennia. So the evidence was overwhelming, and I decided that you have to back the evidence rather than the weight of conventional historiographical opinion. Another reason is also the neglect in curricula. I think that's shocking the fact that Kashmir is just not taught in school or in college or encouraged in research. I'm talking of early Kashmir, for example. Even in medieval Kashmir, really it is Mughal Kashmir that begins to find references. And finally, maybe you'll have a few research projects on the early modern and Sheikh Abdullah after that, and that is it. So actually some of the most warming, this book, by God's grace, has done very well. It has been received exceptionally well across the world and in India. But what was the most heartwarming feedback for me was when random young people from the valley found me out on Facebook, messaged me and told me, "We read your book. Thank you, ma'am. We didn't know this is our history." So for me, that told me that, all right, this book has done its job in terms of forcing our collective attention back to a region that has been exceptional, in pioneering and leading from the front virtually all intellectual and cultural movements across the Indian subcontinent. That is a huge claim I'm making, but I back it. And again, not for one or two centuries, but for nearly a millennium and a half, at least. So it is high time that we in India, we students of history, know about Kashmir and know our Kashmir. What do we have another question? Ishan?
I think there's one last question, and it's a very small question. It is about the, where does Kashmir get its name from? And she, the person is Marisha, and she read this, that it comes from one of the Saptarishi, that is Rishi Kashyap. So is that true?
So there are three possible meanings of the name Kashmir, and they are not mutually exclusive meanings. So one is Kashmira is a name of Durga, is a name of Uma or Parvati, Kashmira. And that is deemed as one reason that Kashmir, because she is Parvati, is called Kashmir. And the Nilmat Puran tells us that. The Nilmat Puran, which is the local Puran of Kashmir, the Sthala Puran of Kashmir, composed in the 7th century CE. The Nilmat also gives us the second possible origins, and which is the association with Rishi Kashyap. So the Sati Sar that I told you about, the lake of Sati that Kashmir was at one point inhabited by a demon called Jalodbhava. And what is fascinating, I have to mention this, is that this motif of a demon inhabiting a lake, and when that demon is killed, a region emerges from that lake. This motif, this story, is actually found all along the Himalayas. So there is a version of this in Garhwal, there's a version of this in Tibet, there's a version of this in Nepal, and right till Arunachal Pradesh, if you please. So there is something, and I personally believe that maybe this is myth serving as remote cultural memory, because it is not a coincidence that the entire Himalayas, and certainly the entire Himalayas, have risen from the sea. We know that, right? And we also know that Kashmir in particular, geologists have demonstrated this, emerged from a primordial lake and the desiccation and drying up of that lake. And again, we know this from the deposits of that lake, ancient lake or sea, that have been found, which actually form the what are called the Karevas in Kashmir, the geologic formation. Some of the hills that you see are not mountains, they are actually Karevas, the sediment deposits in Kashmir. And we have found fossils of sea animals and sea fish all along the Himalayas and also in Kashmir. So what I'm saying is that, why did the peoples of this region have this originary myth, this cosmogonic myth of emerging from a lake? I think the coincidence is too much to ignore that in science too, this region did emerge from a lake, and Kashmir certainly did. I think there's no denying that the myth is capturing that. How they knew that, don't ask me, but they obviously did. So Jalodbhava is a demon who inhabits the Satisar Lake at one point, and the residents of Kashmir go to Rishi Kashyap and appeal to him for help, and he goes to the gods and asks them to intervene. So all the major gods, Shiva, Vishnu, Parvati, they come there, but so also does Krishna and Balaram, and it is actually Balaram with his hala who breaks the embankment of that lake draining the waters out and thereby killing Jalodbhava, the demon. And so that that land that emerges from the drying up of the lake is Kashmir. And hence the association with Rishi Kashyap. And the third meaning of Kashmir, again, the Nilmat tells us, is not very far removed from what we have been talking of till now, and which is from the word for water, the syllable for water, which is also ka, ka. And the Nilmat spells this out. So hence Kashmir, the land of water. And till today, if you reflect on the beautiful landscape and topography of Kashmir, it is a wetland ecology. What are called the Nagas of Kashmir are nothing but the lakes that have remained from that ancient process of drying up of the larger lake. So there is the nomenclature of Kashmir is actually deeply rooted in her geographic and her cultural history.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for introducing Kashmir to all of us in a very fresh new perspective, a very fresh new lens to the entire early history of Kashmir. And I hope this is going to be a stepping stone for many further researches. All of the students who are watching us now will go and read your book, The Making of Early Kashmir, that is available on Amazon. Please do check that book out. It's a great book. Thank you so much, ma'am. It was truly an honor to host you this evening.
Thank you so much. It has been a great pleasure. And I would look forward to a lot many more books on Kashmir and research on Kashmir emerging from this lecture. That would be a great outcome. Thank you, Ishan. Thank you very much. Yes. Namaskar.
Thank you, ma'am. And thank you very much, everybody who watched this live. The lecture will be available on our YouTube channel by tomorrow morning. So do check that out. Do share that with your friends, family, and every history student, your friends. Thank you so much and have a great evening.
Thank you. All the very best.